having said that, Father, I just ask that you would help me tonight, not be, oh, God, you know I can be so wordy. And Lord, I just pray that there would be a succinct teaching tonight, that you would say what you need to say through me. I yield myself to you, and you know my weaknesses and what I can't do. So, Father, I thank you that in Christ, this church can do all things by your grace through faith and love. And so I thank you tonight for instruction, for training. Father, put some tools in our hearts that we can pull out and use when we are confronted with this everyday life of the 21st century, this craziness that we live in right now, this information world that we can't get away from. Help us to be righteous judges, Lord, according to your will and your way. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've got your Bibles, I want you to turn with me to the book of Luke. And we're going to be looking at judgment and justice. And what does God say about it? What did Jesus model? Because if you want to know what you and I are supposed to look like and are supposed to model ourselves after, it's Jesus. He became a man and he showed us how we can become the people that he wants us to be. As he is in this world, so are we. Therefore, there's a transformation taking place in our lives. And he taught us about the kingdom of God and about the realm that we cannot see. And, you know, vision is something that you can't see, but you know by faith. Sight, seeing, is what you can see in the natural. And God wants to infuse vision into our lives and our hearts, not depression and poverty and frustration and prejudice and all of this foolishness that's going on right now in a nation that is completely in upheaval because of the powers of darkness. And the church is called to shine the light and to bring peace. So here's what the Lord says in Luke chapter 6. If you've got your Bibles, turn there with me. We're going to be looking at verse 37 and verse 38. Again, the title of this message is Judgment and Justice. In verse 37, it says, judge not, and you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you shall be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. So here we see Jesus saying, don't judge, judge not, and you shall not be judged. It's a boomerang law. Then he goes on to say, and if you'll look down there with me at verse 39, and he spoke a parable to them. Can the blind lead the blind? Will they not both fall into a ditch? Now, a parable is a physical story of a spiritual truth. So he's saying, can two blind people lead each other? They can't see. So the blind leading the blind is ludicrous. They're going to fall into a ditch, right? Because they can't see. A disciple is not above his teacher. But everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher. So now he's talking about the point of the story. When you're blind, you can't see. But when you're a disciple, when you listen and do what your teacher says to do, and you are grown up and mature, you're going to be just like your teacher. So if I'll listen to what he says about judgment, I'll be like him, and I'll grow up like him, and I'll judge correctly. And then he goes on to say, and why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not perceive the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, brother, let me remove the speck that is in your eye, when you yourself do not see the plank that is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck that is in your brother's eye. Now here he is talking about, he says, don't judge. So you won't be judged because it's a boomerang law. The measure that you judge is what's going to come back to you. Forgive and you'll be forgiven. If you don't forgive, you won't be forgiven. Don't condemn or you won't be condemned. He says, give and it'll be given back to you. You see, it's a law of sowing and reaping. It's a law of reciprocity. It's a law of when I put in something, I'm going to get something back. It's a give and take. Are you with me? When you plant a seed, you're going to have a harvest. You don't plant a seed to die. You plant a seed to grow. Whatever is in that seed is already programmed to be what it's supposed to be. If I plant corn, I'm going to get a corn stalk, right? If I plant an acorn, I'm going to get an oak tree, because inside that acorn seed is already programmed an oak tree. So in God's word, the promises of God are programmed in the promise. They will bring, God's word has the power to bring itself to come to pass. when it's planted in a heart that is good soil. So he says, listen, he says, he's sharing with us a comparison. I don't have a bottle of water. Can I have a bottle of water? Can somebody just throw me a bottle of water? No, I need a big one. I'll show you something. He's comparing. He says, listen, a blind man can't lead a blind man things. Why do you say to your brother, don't judge your brother? How can you judge your brother? You judge your brother and you say to him, and this is what he says. Let's read it again. Will you go there with me? Luke chapter 6. Let's look at verse 42. How can you say to your brother, brother, let me remove the speck that is in your eye when you yourself do not see the plank that is in your own eye? Hypocrite. First, remove the plank from your own eye, and then you can see clearly to remove the speck that's in your brother's. He's talking about judgment. He's talking about us looking at each other. So let's just say plank, okay? Let's just pretend that I had a 2x4, which I don't have. Okay, now a speck is a little piece of dust. Have you ever gotten a hair or a piece of sand or a speck in your eye? It just drives you nuts. You can't see it because it's so small. And Jesus is comparing a speck to a plank. This is the biggest thing I can figure. But let's just say we had a 2x4, a sequoia. Okay, how about a trunk of a sequoia tree hanging out our eyes, and we're trying to get the speck out of somebody else's eye. Dan, come here a second. Let's just see how foolish this is. This is a parable. This is a story. Dan, you have a speck in your eye. I wish I had something bigger, but this will just have to do. Now, Dan, I want to help get that out of your eye. Come here. Come here. Where are you going? What are you doing? Huh? See how foolish it is? You can't even get close enough to see clearly. You can't even get close enough to know what's really wrong. And God is comparing my life with somebody else's. He says, Debbie, you got a plank. You got a 2x4 in your eye. And you're trying to remove this speck in your brother's eye. You see, God is saying, don't judge. Why? Because we're not qualified to judge certain things. Because we can't see clearly. He says, before you can judge, you're going to have to remove the plank in your eye so that you can see clearly to now carefully get the speck out of your brother's. What a statement. Because it's so easy for us to nail each other, to look at somebody else, and to say, well, this is who they are, and this is what they're doing. Isn't that what our nation is doing right now? And Jesus said, a kingdom divided against itself cannot stand. And America right now is divided between the blue and the red, between races, between ideologies, social economic platforms. We are a divided people. And nothing is getting done because God says that a kingdom divided can do nothing. But when we are united in effort, nothing will be impossible to us. Now, he wants his people to be joined together in unity. And it's not going to happen if we're like the world judging each other. So what am I to judge and how am I to do it? Well, number one, I'm going to just give you three things. Three things we're to do tonight. He tells us that we're first and foremost to judge ourselves. I got a plank, you got a speck. That's the comparison. So he says, before you can help the person with the speck, that's his idea of what's wrong with them is a speck. I got to get the plank out of your eye because you're a mess. So when we're going to judge, before we can even begin to look at anybody else, God says, you're going to have to judge yourself. I got to remove the beam out of my own eye so I can help others get the speck of dust out of theirs. You know, the slippery slope of self-righteousness is very subtle. Man, is it subtle. You know, you can just think everything's okay, you're doing good, and you're looking around you, and you're looking at this group of people, and this group of people, and this part of the body of Christ, and this doctrine over here, and that doctrine over there, and before you know it, you're nailing them, boy. You're just nailing them, but you still got a plank in your eye, so we're destroying each other instead of helping each other. Do you see what God is saying? So, and the problem is, he says, judge not that you not be judged. Because the measure that you judge is what's going to come back to you. It's the boomerang. How I send out judgment is what's going to come back to me. So he says, listen, you don't want somebody with planks in their eyes trying to get the speck out of yours, right? Because what you send out is what's going to come back. So I want to just look at a couple of things about judging myself. I've got to remove the beam. So what does that mean to judge myself? Well, first and foremost, let's look. I think that there's some verses that we need to look at. 1 Corinthians 11:31 says, and we do this in communion. I mean, this is a very big deal here. We believe that we need to take the Lord's Supper worthily. We need to search ourselves. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says, for if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. In other words, take a look at where you're at before you take over the communion table. Don't eat unworthily. Are you born again? Are you? Where are you at? And then in 1 Peter chapter 4, if I could have that one up, it says, for the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of Jesus Christ? The time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. Where God begins judgment is with his people. Why? Because he's got to get the plank out of us so we can remove the speck out of others. That's what he is saying. So God says, I need you, first and foremost, not to look at what's wrong with other people. I need you to look at yourself. So I've got a number one, Number one is judge myself. But what does that mean? It means, okay, I'm going to have to be honest before God. I'm going to have to get honest. And I want to look at a story. A real live incident that happened in Luke chapter 7. If you go there with me, it's between Jesus and Simon and a woman that was a notorious sinner. She was probably a prostitute, it doesn't say, but she was a wicked woman. So Simon in Luke chapter 7, and it's in verse, we're going to look at verse 37. I'm just going to tell you the story, then we're going to look at it. So Simon is a Pharisee. He's a religious leader. Jesus is in town, and he has him over for dinner. So he puts out this beautiful dinner, and he's rich, and he's wealthy, and he's somebody, and he's got a circle of influence and friends, and they're seated at this dinner, and this woman comes in, and she crashes the party. They're all seated, and they're all having dinner, and she just barges in, and Jesus is reclining because they sat on the floor, and they ate. And so his feet are tucked behind him. And she stands behind him, and she starts crying. Just probably racking sobs, because it says that her tears wet his feet. So that tells me that this one's probably snotting everywhere, and she's crying everywhere. And then she undoes her hair, and she pulls her hair down, and she leans down. She's got a flask, an alabaster flask of oil. But she takes her hair, and then she wipes his feet with her hair. So her tears are washing his feet. Then she undoes her hair, which, you know, that's a pretty intimate thing. And in the meantime, everybody's having dinner. And then she washes his feet with her tears. She wipes them with her hair. And then she opens his flask and she anoints his head and she anoints him. Now, everybody is watching this. And Simon says to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know what a wicked woman this is. He wouldn't let her touch him. Now we're talking about judgment. So, chapter 7, let's go there. I'm looking at verse 39. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she's a sinner. Now we're talking about getting the plank out of our eyes. And Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. I love it. And he says, teacher, say it. Verse 41. Well, I'm going to tell you a story. There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii. And a denarii was a day's wage. So one owed him 500 days of wages. 500 denarii, that's a lot of money. It's over a year's salary. It's almost 2 years. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? And Simon answered and said, well, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said, you have rightly judged. Now you're getting it, Simon. You see, Jesus knew exactly what Simon was thinking in his heart about this woman. Jesus knew exactly what Simon was judging in his heart about this woman that had crashed his dinner party. And now he says, Simon, you've rightly judged. We're talking about getting the beam out of our eyes so we can get the speck out of somebody else's. And he turned to the woman and he said to Simon, do you see this woman? This is amazing to me. He turns and he looks at Simon. Now, guys, have you ever had people over for dinner? Anybody ever had people over for dinner? Have you ever had anybody crash your house, come in, and just cry hysterically and start wiping the feet of the guest of honor and start pouring oil all over? I mean, have you ever had that happen? No. And then Jesus says to Simon, Simon, do you see this woman? Really? Do I see her? Do I see her? Jesus, how can I miss her? She has a beam in her life. She's a wicked woman. She's a sinner. Do I see her? How can you not see her? But Jesus said, do you see her? What is he saying? He's saying, what do we see when we look at people? Because God doesn't see like we see. We see with the judgment of our own hearts, through the perspective of our own lens, through the color of skin that we were raised in, if we were born into tribes and we were prejudiced in our families. We see if we're male or female. We see where we live, where we've lived. We see what neighborhoods we've lived in. We see everything but what God sees about humanity. How can I judge humanity when I've got a plank in my eye like Simon? If he only knew who she was, he wouldn't touch her. And he says, I love this. Do you see this woman? Do you see this woman? I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. You've given me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You gave me no kiss. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, he knew exactly who she was. He knew exactly where she was from. He knew exactly what she'd been doing. He's God Almighty in the flesh. Though her sins are many, they are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. And he looked at the woman and he said, your sins are forgiven. What does that mean? It means when she realized who he was, he was the God in flesh. He was the one that could forgive her. He was the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. This probably little hoe that had a life that could not be reconciled by the law that she lived under. When she knew who he was, she had to bust through, crash through. She had to weep and anoint him and bring her most valuable gift. And she had to be at his feet because she knew who he was and that he could forgive her. And it was more important that she do that than what people thought or what people wanted to do with her when they threw her out of the house. To whom there is much forgiveness, there is much love. But you see, Simon didn't have a lot to forgive. He only owed $50. Why? Because he was disciplined. He kept the law. He knew how to keep the word. He went to church every week. He knew how to pray, and he knew how to read the word, and he knew how to follow the religious traditions of his faith. You see, Simon only owed God $50. Simon had a plank in his eye, and she just had a speck of dust in hers. And Jesus could see clearly, so he could take the dust out and heal her and bring her to a new life. See, that's why if I'm going to judge, and I'm supposed to, there's some things I need to judge. God doesn't say not to. I better judge right. I better judge right. So first I got to get honest with God. I got to see where I'm at. And then I got to remember that God is faithful to help me change. Philippians 1:6, and if I can have that up. Because, you know, you can get so hard on yourself that now you hate yourself. And it says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it into the day of Jesus Christ. You see, yeah, we used to be, but we're not now. And I may fail, and I may trip up, and I may mess up, and I may get it wrong. And I might feel sometimes like I'm always the one that has to say sorry. I'm always apologizing to God or somebody in my family for something. You know what? And you can get hard on yourself. But God says, remember that I have judged you. And I have sanctified you, and I have saved you, and I have washed you, and I'm the one that's going to cleanse you, and I'm the one that's going to perfect that which concerns you until the day of my coming. And I know exactly who you are and what you need, and I'm here for you. And if you'll just help me be honest and let me change you, you'll actually step into the personhood that I've ordained for you to be. You know, I had this dream the other night. I mean, this has been an interesting year. It's taking our hands off the ministry and turning it over. And now what, God? You know, I'm 66. And okay, am I supposed to get a job? Are we supposed to go into business? What are we supposed to do? You know, kind of twiddling our thumbs. Not knowing. Just up in limbo. Anybody ever been in limbo? And you know, sometimes you can get hard on yourself. And I had a dream last week. And in the dream, the Lord came to me. I didn't see him. I just felt him and heard him. I didn't see his face. But he took my face in his two hands. And in the dream, like a father, he said, Debbie, I want you to enjoy being you because I enjoy you. And I believe that's not just a word for me. I believe that's a word for you. That God loves you. He wants you to enjoy being who you are. Not somebody else, who you are. He made you. He knows what you've gone through. He knows the challenges that you face. He knows what's going on in your life. He knows the highs and the lows. He knows what you struggle with. He knows how you get discouraged about things. He knows how you get frustrated. He knows every single thing about you. He knows the worst thing about you, and he would not tell a soul because he made you, and he loves you, and he's perfecting that which concerns you. You know, there's a verse, and I just want to, and we'll go on to the next point, just to kind of bring this point home. Remember that God is faithful to help me change. And Paul wrote this in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, if I could just have it up there. It says, it's a very small thing to me that I should be judged by you or by human courts. In fact, I don't even judge myself, for I know nothing against myself, yet I'm not justified by this. But he who judges me is the Lord. You see, there just comes a time when you got to step back from your life. And you just got to say, wait a minute. The beam's removed. I've been and I am in love with him. I may not be what I want to be, but I'm not where I was. And God says, listen, relax. Relax. Enjoy being you. You don't have to fit into this mold or this mold or this mold. I want you to be you. And you don't have to worry about whether somebody's judging you or not judging you. Listen, whenever you stand in this place, like I am right now, I'm getting judgment. That's just part of being in front of people. Now I'm an old woman, not a young woman. I faced it all my life. And Paul faced it. There were enemies that said he's a false apostle. And he said, you know what? I don't even care if you judge me. He's judged himself. He knows God's going to perfect that which concerns him. He's taken the beam out. He's been honest with God. And now he can just be Paul and be who he's supposed to be. Just very comfortable in being who he is at whatever stage you are in life. But first, you got to get the plank out, and that's how. So be honest with God. Let God deal with you. And then learn the lessons, but forget the details. Learn the lessons, but forget the details. Yeah, he's disciplined you. Yeah, he's talked to you. Yeah, this has happened. Yeah, this disappointment came through. Yes, that happened. Lessons were learned. But forget the details and move on. Move on, because now you're growing up and you're ready to be used by God. So number one, we got to start with ourselves. Get the beam out, judge ourselves, get honest with God. Number two, you okay with me? Judge in love. Now we got to judge. What does that look like, to judge in love? Proverbs 3:3-4 says, let not mercy and truth forsake you. Mercy and truth. The word mercy there is a Hebrew word hased, and it's loving kindness. It's covenant loyal love. It's not a word that actually can be translated into English. So they translated it into loving kindness, but it's everything that God is. It's like the womb of a mother that just yearns for her child and has mercy for her child, and she cares and she hears the cry of that child and she feeds that child, and she has said she blesses and she loves and she nourishes and she takes care of that child. That is the Father's love. Let not mercy, has said, loving kindness and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Like I've got this scarf around my neck. It's bound around my neck. God says, let mercy, let hesed, let loving kindness, let loyal covenant love be bound around you like a necklace, like the scarf. Write them on the tablets of your heart, and so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and of man. Now that I've got the plank out of my eye, now I can judge in the love of God and the hesed, the loving kindness of God, mercy and truth. What is truth? Truth is God's word. Jesus said in John 17:17, thy word is truth. There is no other standard whereby you and I can judge what is truth and what is not truth, because there is deception in this world. There's only one standard of truth. It's not what the news media says. It's not the Republicans say, the Democrats, what one political party says about another nation. It's what God's word says. He says death. He says that there's not one jot or tittle of this book that's going to pass away. It's eternal. It will stand for all generations and for eternity, and it is truth. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 6 says, love, agape, God's love, God's hesed, God's love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Mercy. What is mercy? Mercy, loving kindness, the agape of God. What is it? How do I judge? I judge by the standard of God's word. Listen, when something is happening in my family, when I have to judge the situation, when I've got to judge that which is spiritual, when it is important that I judge, because we will make judgments, and to think that we're not to judge is wrong. We're going to judge angels, guys. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul's writing to the church of Corinth and say, don't you know that you're going to judge angels, and there's nobody in your church that can judge situations? You're going to court outside of the kingdom of God, outside of the body of Christ, and you're actually taking your problems to secular people that don't know God, and there's not somebody in the church that's wise enough to judge what's right and what's wrong. We are to judge sin. We are to judge. We're supposed to, but we got to get the plank out so we can see the speck. Are you with me? So, mercy and truth. Well, what's mercy? Mercy bears all things. 1 Corinthians 13:7, look on the board. What does mercy do? Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. So it bears, believes, hopes, and endures all things. It bears, believes, hopes, and endures all things. It bears, it carries. It carries all things. Things that are good and things that aren't so good in your family. Things that you like about your husband that you don't like about your husband. Things that you love about your kids and you don't so love about your kids. Things you like about your church and you don't so like about your church. Are you hearing me? Bears. It carries. Love covers a multitude of sins and shortcomings. Listen, we are going to run into each other in this life. We are going to collide. We will have glaring inconsistencies. And the closer we get, the more we can see what we don't like. Are you with me? And God says, listen, I know that, but I've got it covered. Because if you'll love, if you'll put truth, my standard is the truth. You don't bring my standard down to yours. You bring your standards up to mine. Period. Pastor Dan preached it this morning. Holiness, our inheritance, our birthright. I am not to bring God's standard down to this carnal world and what the world says is right and wrong, how the world defines marriage and sex and this life in the 21st century is relevant. That's foolish. They're changing all the time. They're going to pass away. They're going to live 78 years and they're going to be gone. But the eternal God that spoke and made heaven and earth, and he spoke and it was, he wrote it down for us to live it. And he says, bring your life to my standards. Truth. That's how I judge. In my home, when we were raising our children, it was a standard that we raised our kids. Hey, you are going to church. you're not playing soccer and you're not playing hockey on Sunday. Sorry, you're going to the house of God, because if you will go to the house of God, you will flourish and you will be blessed. But guess what? You're going to someday not play soccer anymore and you're not going to care about hockey anymore. Hello? No, you're not wearing that bikini. No, you're not going out in that miniskirt. No, you're not going to do that. I don't care. I don't care if all your friends are doing it. What? If your friends jumped off the cliff, you'd all jump off the cliff together? If you said that as parents? Listen, your kids don't tell you what to do. You are the parent. You are the parent. Well, I don't tell God what to do. He's God. He made me. He has my days numbered. He knows the hairs on my head, how many there are today and how many there were when I was 30. There was a lot more then. He knows us. He made us. He fashioned us. He formed us. He has designated our spots. He's designated the works that he's called us to do and to walk in and to bear fruit and to have dominion and to multiply and subdue and to be his church in the 21st century and live amazing lives of love. But we got to learn how to do this. So we got to learn how to judge in love and truth. Truth is his word. Mercy. What is mercy? Well, James talks about it. I got to get going. I'm almost done. Are you all right with me? Okay. If you go with me to James chapter 2, we're going to see what this is. And James chapter 2, and if it's not on the overhead, because there was a lot of scripture, just bring your Bibles or your phones or your tablets and look it up. James 2, verse 1 says, my brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. It's an interesting word, partiality. In the Old King James, it says respect of persons, and it's a Greek word, and I wrote it down. It is prosopoleteo. Oh, my goodness, I don't speak Greek. So I'm not going to even try that again. But it's made from two words. It's made from phroneho, which means face, and it from lambano, which means to take hold of. So it means to take hold of the face, partiality, to take hold of a face. Now, what does that mean? It means, listen to this, showing preference for the rich and the powerful, making distinctions among people based on their rank, their race, or their influence. It's to take hold of the face. It's to look at somebody and to judge them by how they look, whether it's race or rank or influence. He says in chapter 2 of James, my brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. Don't do that. Don't take hold. Don't make distinctions. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, homeless, let's just say, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, you sit here in a good place, or here, sit at my footstool. Have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brethren. Has God not chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he promised to those who love him? But you've dishonored the poor. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you are called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. Here comes the royal law, the agape of God, the love of God bears all things, hopes all things, endures all things. It carries everything. It doesn't think a wrong. It doesn't look at somebody and nail them. It doesn't look at the homeless and say, you're just a bum. It wonders, God, what happened to you? You were once a baby in your mother's womb. She didn't raise you to be homeless. She didn't raise you to be destroyed like this. What did the devil do to your life? Are you hearing what I'm saying? This is what built this church. It was the love of God, and it was the mercy of God, and it was when God began to get in our hearts and said, stop nailing people and start loving people to life and not judging them to death. Then this church started to grow. We started getting a new look at people and humanity. He says, what are you doing? You're judging them. They're looking at their faces, their color, their rank, their social order. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he's guilty of all. In other words, the law cannot save us. We broke one part of it. It was all broken. all broken. There's only one law that can save us. It's the royal law of the love of God. For he who said, do not commit adultery, do not murder. Now, if you don't commit adultery, but you do murder, you become a transgressor of the law. It doesn't matter. You can never be good enough. Why are you judging everybody? Why are you looking at the color of the skin, the gender, how rich they are, how poor they are? Why are you looking at them and judging them that way? He says this, so speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty, the law of God, the love of God. For judgment, can I have that up? For judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Listen. What is that saying? God's love will trump judgment. God's love will overrule a bad life. God's love will look at a life that's lost and dying and broken and wrong and can never fix it, like that woman, like Simeon, like Simon. My gosh, she was a wicked woman. She couldn't undo her life, but there was one in her midst. If she could just get to him, if she could just get close enough to him, the God of the universe could actually cleanse her and forgive her and give her a new life and a new hope and a new start. And you see, now here we are, the church. God says, I need you to be me on the earth. I need you to love people to life, not judge them to death. When we do that, we begin to release an atmosphere of change. People become safe. And instead of nailing them, we begin to release them into becoming what they can be. Like God said to me in that dream, Debbie, enjoy being you because I enjoy you. Enjoy the humanity that God's brought to us. The person sitting on your right, the person sitting on your left, the one way in the back, the one that comes every so often and you wonder, where did they go? We have no idea what they're going through. We have no idea what's happened to them or what they face when they go home. And yet it's so easy to just take the swords out and to slice and dice. But this church started in the mercy of God. Because God said to Jim and I, put wool on your backs and I've sent you out of the sheepfold. You're going to need mercy and not get it. So when you come again and hold the shepherd's rod in your hand, you will know how to give mercy to my people. You won't put them in a box and say, this is who you are and you'll never change and you'll never be anything but this. No. Now we can say, welcome. Come. Come into the presence of the King. Come and become all that you can be. You are now being who you're supposed to be, fully human, fully redeemed, fully restored, and fully beloved of God. That's the atmosphere of judgment. Mercy triumphs over judgment. So, last one. So how do I judge? I judge in truth and in love. What does that mean? It means I'm long-suffering. It means when I want to nail somebody, I shuttest thou uppest. It means I don't just say things about people, but I come under the authority of the love of God. I come under the authority of that word that says love bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things. Love endures all things. Okay, I may not understand why they're acting that way. I may not understand what in the world has gone on in their life, but I'm not their judge. Jesus is, and my job is to stand in the gap as an intercessor, to love them to life, to be everything I can be, to give them an atmosphere of some kind of safety so they can come in and get washed by the word of God and get changed as God begins to come inside of them. So I got to get honest with God. I got to get the plank out of my eye. How do we judge? I got to get the plank out. I got to see clearly so I can judge. Number two, when I can see clearly, now I can judge in truth, which is his word, and mercy, which is hesed, agape love. Number three, the last one, judge nothing before the time. How do I judge? First, I got to get clear vision. I got to get the plank out of my eye. Learn the lessons, forget the details, move on with your life. You know how I can tell everybody my testimony? There's not a twinge of shame. You know why? Because it's another life. I've been so washed in the word over these last 40 years that what I did as a foolish woman who should have been in jail and wasn't is just another person in another life. And it's just a testimony. God removes the shame of our past. He gets the plank out of our eyes when we get honest with him. Then comes mercy. comes love, comes the chesed, the loving kindness and loyalty, covenant love of God, that we are committed to each other, that love bears all things, hopes all things, endures all things, believes all things, that I'm not going to speak against, but I'm going to believe for. Yes, their children are a mess right now, but guess what? My children were a mess, and I remember when my kids were a mess, but somebody believed with me that my kids would serve God one day. You see, when we judge each other, we stop. The atmosphere of power and love that changes things. That's what God is trying to say to us. The last thing is judge nothing before the time. What does that mean? Well, let's look at this and says, let's go back to Luke 6 and we're going to close with this and I'm done. Luke 6:38. Don't judge tomorrow by today. Judge not and you'll not be judged. Condemn not and you'll not be condemned. Forgive and you'll be forgiven. Given it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over. Will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. 1 Corinthians 4:5 says, therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the hearts. Then each one's praise will come from God. God says, listen, don't let other people judge you and don't worry about their judgment. And don't judge anything before the time. Don't judge tomorrow by today. Don't judge your tomorrows by this today. Because anything can happen with God. One word from God can change everything. One suddenly from God and everything's different. You see, he said it's a boomerang. If you don't judge, then judgment won't come back to you. If you forgive, you'll be forgiven. If you don't condemn, you will not be condemned. If you give your life away, and that's what Pastor Dan taught us at the beginning of this year, grow. Remember? The first was giving. Of our time, our talents, and our treasure. Do you remember that? Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You see, God wants to bless us. God wants miracles to come to us. And I love what Oral Roberts said about this. And Oral Roberts was a great man of God, and he had a healing ministry, if you don't know who he is. But this is what he said about this. As I live in truth and love, taking out the beam in my own eye, learning to love people to life, not judging the death, miracles are coming towards me. Now, that's not what he said. That's what I said. But this is what he said. Remain sensitive at all times as to how God will deliver your harvest. A miracle is either coming towards you or going past you all the time. A miracle is either coming to you or going past you all the time. A miracle. He saw miracles. Oral Roberts. A miracle is either coming to you or it's going past you all the time. Don't let it pass by. It could be an idea, an invention, an invitation. An opportunity, a relationship that you thought was not going to pan out. God has a due season. Be expectant. Believe, he said. Believe. It's either coming to you or it's passing by you. But be expectant because God says, give and it'll be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. You see, God wants to prosper us. God wants to give us the Holy Spirit. God wants to empower the church. God wants this place packed out with lines going out the door, waiting to hear the word of God. God wants the millennial generation, the sleeping, beautiful princess, to be kissed by her king and wake up and be all that she is supposed to be, the bride of Christ in this generation. But it's going to take a generation like us that's going to believe. That's going to see what can't be seen. That's not going to judge people to death, but love them to life. That's willing to take the beam out of our eyes so we can remove the speck in our brothers. So how do we judge? We get honest with God. First, judgment begins with us, with me. First me. Get the beam out, Debbie. Then I can use you to help get a speck out of somebody else. Number two, judge in truth and love. My word and my mercy, my chesed. Number three, don't you dare, child, judge tomorrow by today because you have a due season. It's coming. Be expectant. It's either coming to you or passing by you. Go get it. Press in. That woman with the issue of blood hadn't pressed through the crowd and touched his garment, she wouldn't have gotten healed. If those friends had not taken the roof off of that house and lowered their friend down in front of Jesus, he would never have been healed. You see, you got to press in. You got to get in. You got to get that miracle. You got to do what God's told you to do. And you got to believe God and not quit because there is a due season of blessing coming our way. if we will love people to life and not judge them to death and learn how to be righteous judges for our King on this earth. I hope you got something out of tonight. We're done. We're done, and we're going home. So when you hear all the stuff, or your family wants to get into a debate with you, just love them. Let it go. Choose your battles. Don't get into those. They're giants to take out, and those are not the giants. How much drama have we had in our lives that we didn't need to have? Okay, how many of you know who Donald Trump is? How many of you think he has created a lot of his own battles with his mouth or his tweets? Yes, there you go. We can all learn, can't we? Now, before we leave, I don't know everybody here, and I certainly can't see everybody here because I could put my glasses on and then I could see you. So I don't know if you're right with God or not. But you see, all that I said, none of that makes any difference until you surrender your heart and your life to Jesus Christ and let him and invite him in to be your Savior and your Lord. He made you. He knows you. He knows the worst thing about you. He's not in shock or therapy over your sin or your life. But he is inviting you to come and step out of that and step into the life that he has for you. He died. He went to a cross. He carried the sin of the world on him because he was the only one that could, because he was God in the flesh. And he said, if you'll look to that cross and you'll believe, you'll let me be Savior, which means you can't save yourself, and your good works and your efforts cannot get you to heaven. You've got to come my way. And I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And you can't get to the Father except through me. That means I have to come to the cross, and I have to look and know that I need a Savior, and he's it. And then I have to invite him in because he's a gentleman, and he doesn't force his way into your life. We invite him to be Savior and Lord. Lord means boss. It means, okay, I may not get this. I may not understand much of it, but I know that you're God, and you made me. And I want to give my life to you. I don't trust myself, but you said you'd perfect that which concerns me, and I'm willing to step in. Will you be my Lord and Savior? And you see, when you do that, you invite him, and he becomes your Savior, and he comes into your life, and you are born again. You're hooked up back with God. Your spirit is eternal, and you can't see it, but it happens. If you've never done that, if you've never surrendered your heart and your life to him, he loves you. He loved you so much he didn't want to do heaven without you. How about that? But you've never given him your life. Tonight, he brought you here for that. In this rainstorm, you're here sitting in these chairs so you can get right with God. Because he doesn't want you walking out of here tonight not right with him, because you don't have tomorrow, but you got tonight. So I just would like every head bowed, every eye closed. Just put your precious little heads down. No peeking. We want to give you a moment of privacy. Most of you in here, I'm speaking to the church, but there might be somebody in here that's never surrendered heart and life to him, making him Savior and Lord. If you've never, ever let him be Savior and Lord, and you'd like to surrender your life to him tonight, I'd just like you to lift your hand right now. Let me just see it quickly. Just quickly lift your hand. I'm not going to slap my hands or count to three tonight. We're just going to ask in a moment of privacy if you'd like to get right with God. Just lift your hand and I'll see it and God will see it. Anybody in here? I see that hand. I'll just give you a moment. Anybody else? Ushers, could you help me? Because I don't want to put my glasses on. There's one hand. There's two hands. Anybody else? Anybody else? Okay. Two hands went up. So let's do this. We're going to pray. You don't get saved by asking Jesus into your life by raising your hand. You get saved by actually praying and having a moment with him. And this is what we'd like to do is we're going to stand. We're going to leave in just a moment. But if you raise your hand and you want to get right with God, as we stand, we'd like to just have you grab your personal possessions and bring a friend with you if you need to. Just come down and we're going to pray. We're going to pray with you, not in front of everybody, but we are going to pray in another room with you. And just so you know, you can remember, and then we're going to give you a Bible and do some things to help you grow in the Lord. So if that was you, or if you didn't raise your hands and you wish you would have, just come down quickly. We're just not going to make a big deal out of this, but it is a big deal. It's changing your eternity. It's a very big deal.
Love of the Lord,
so if you raise your hands, if you could just come down. I saw two hands up there. If you guys would just come.
Mercy never comes.
It's okay. It's okay. Come on down. Let's get right. Oh, if you only knew what rascals Jim and I were. My gosh. Divorced three times before he was 25, and I was married to a drug dealer. Oh. God wasn't in shock over our sin. He said, I'll clean you up. I'll bring you together and give you a life. And look at what he's done. You see, God loves us. He's the only one that can fix us. If you don't trust yourself, you can't, because you can't fix you. But, oh, he can. He can fix you. Are you beautiful? My goodness, look at you. Fearfully and wonderfully made. And you know what? You can smile at me, because you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party. It's yours. He didn't make you for hell. He made you for heaven. Come on. Let's get right. How beautiful. How lovely. How lovely are you? How lovely are you? This is Pastor Joelle. We're going to pray with you privately, okay? And if you'll just turn this way. Which way is that? That way. We're going to pray with you privately. We love you. Good call.